On the agenda for tonight's live analysis, we're going back to 1982. We're going to be taking a look at Rainbow, and they're going to be performing Tearing Out My Heart. Hello, Phil here from Wings of Pegasus, and welcome to this live analysis. Thank you everyone for joining me there in the live chat room. So I'm going to be jumping into this one about halfway through, and it is going to be a long one. It's just over 8.5 minutes in length, this whole performance, and at the end it does suddenly cut out, so I'll try and catch that when we get to the end of the video. But I will leave a link in the description below so you guys can click on that if you want to watch the whole performance without me interrupting it. But we are going to be taking a look at Rainbow, but really focusing in on Ritchie Blackmore on guitar, maybe trying to explain a few things about his playing as well. We'll see how we get on with that, but let's get the guys up on screen and see how they get on.
First time I saw your face, by your side was the only place that I would wanna be. Sometimes, and I don't know why, love can come or it can pass by. Now you took all the love you gave to me.
I'm just going to jump in here and talk about a dynamic journey that we get from the intro and the way that Ritchie just starts off really clean tone and working his way through this natural minor scale, but also A lot of people will call it the Aeolian mode. We will get into a little bit of that later on, but I don't want to get too complicated with guitar explanations. But just talking about the band as a whole, because we get such a full sound, we've got the organ sound in the background as well, which means that you get that underlayer. So it's always going to be a thick sound, and Richie can just put his lead lines over the top of that, and it's going to sit in there so well. Also, Jolyn Turner here on vocal. Did you notice how in that first verse we're really understated, but then in the second verse there's a whole octave change vocally? So that's one hell of a jump, considering that we're not even hardly at all into the song. Just that second verse, we really do open the taps, and then dynamically we just really do open up from then on, and then we bring it back down again to this particular lead section. And it's interesting because you get to hear the delay that Richie's got on his tone, and he's got pretty much three sounds that he goes to in this performance, with that very clean start with his lead there, and he then gets into the heavier lead sound, but he also has that heavy lead sound with delay, and that's what we just heard here. But he does flick it on and off, and he doesn't play a hell of a lot with that delay. It's mostly just that dirty tone with that reverb in there, and the natural reverb as well in the venue that they're playing, but you might have a touch of that on his sound. But it's so well controlled. Also, when he does start out playing on that super clean tone, you need to have great technique in order just to sell that and not hit lots of open strings. I did mention in that previous Deep Purple video that I did that Richie really does push things to the edge, but this is a great example of him just holding back and playing with such feeling and being able to get the guitar to sing on that super clean tone and have the technique in order to achieve that as well. Another thing that I want to mention just about Richie and this setup and Rainbow as a band, I mean, the band we've got here, you'll hear the backing vocals come in later on as well. So we've got everything kicking off here, such a great live sound. But with Richie, I know that back in the 70s and the 80s, we had a lot of guitarists who would have been the focus, and bands like Van Halen, for example, where the band is named after the guitarist, so they're naturally going to be the focus. And you had a lot of bands like that in the 80s especially, and George Lynch, Lynch Mob, is another one of those guys having the whole band named after the guitarist. But with this, you really do get the sense that Richie is just orchestrating everything, just with his mannerisms, the way that he gives signals with his arms to the drummer and to everybody else in the band as to when to start up, when to bring things down again. And it's all about him, even to the point where you could argue that the vocalist, the front man of the band, isn't really the focus here. It's all about Richie. And a lot of that is to do with the playing, first of all, but secondly, the theatre, the drama that Richie put into his playing as well. And just watching him pushing his playing to the edge, but also pushing the theatre to the edge as well. And it's something that's having the previous singer, which was Dio, by the way, if you don't know, those guys together, they really do, and Dio certainly knew about theatre and getting the drama into a performance, and Richie very much shared that approach. But having the playing ability is also such an important part, because if you put on a show and you put lots of bells and whistles into your showmanship and the theatre of the performance, but then you can't really play, it's not going to work. So you have to make sure you pair it up with great technical ability, and that is definitely something that Richie does in this performance, but it just keeps your attention the whole time. So we are going to be jumping back into the performance, and just look out for the showmanship. Just before we do, actually, I want to mention about this guitar that he's playing, because it's his Fender Strat, and on the, you might not be able to see it, but on the headstock of the guitar, Richie placed something that looks like a machine head, but it's not really. And to give you an idea of his showmanship, the only reason he had that put on the headstock was to get other guitarists wondering about what that did. And it did nothing. He only put it on there, and you might be able to see interviews with Richie when he mentions this, but he only put it on there to try and mess with other guitarists' minds. And something you'll also notice about this performance is the way that when he does change his pickup selection and he goes to maybe the bridge pickup, he'll do a really wide movement with his arm, and it's really hard to spot when he is changing that pickup because of the wide motions that he makes with his arm. Sometimes when he gets into that neck pickup, he'll pull his whole hand up towards him, and sometimes he won't actually change it but make the motion as if he's changing it. So he was one of those guys that would be so dramatic with his movements, but also to throw off other guitarists playing, so you didn't really know what he was doing at any one time. But that is all about the showmanship and just making a spectacle of his playing, and he certainly does that in this performance. So we are going to be jumping back into it, and then we'll get the guitar out at the end to have a little go through exactly, or at least roughly, what Richie's doing and just break down some of these techniques. But let's get back into it. We'll watch it all the way to the end.
Day breaks, shadow be free, but your memory is all to me. No, no, there's nothing I can do about you. All alone in the candlelight, I see your face at night, and I feel all the emptiness without you.
Yeah. there we have it. We just got in that final foot pedal with the crash as well. But, I mean, where do you start with that? Like I said, we are going to get the guitar out and try and break down a little bit of what was going on there. But it was a very long solo, very extended solo, which is right up my street, as I'm sure you guys know by now. This kind of stuff and early 80s, Ritchie Blackmore, but just the overall sound, a little bit distorted guitar, harmony vocals, great lead vocalist, just a great band altogether. But let me get the guitar out and we'll have a little go and see what we can make of it. And the other thing to mention is just when we're talking about Ritchie and his playing and playing his Fender Strat, I saw him talking about playing this particular guitar, which now he doesn't play, because when he was playing it at this time in the early 80s, he actually filed down every fret so that he could make it more easily playable for himself, because with a flat neck, he found that when he did bends, the string slipped out from underneath his finger, so he couldn't play it with a standard stock neck that you'd buy at a shop. And it just goes to show you that even the greatest players change things in order to make a guitar or to make a particular technique work for them rather than copying everybody else. The reason that he doesn't play it anymore is because he'd gone through every fret and filed it down to get it exactly the right shape so that he could do all the bends. He then had it repaired by somebody. And I think it was a friend of a friend or something who didn't know that he had filed down. It must have taken him ages to get it perfect in every fret. So then when he took it to this guy, he then spent a little bit of time without it. It got returned to him and the guy said to him, "Oh, by the way, I could see that the frets were worn, so I've totally relayed it all for you, free of charge." And of course, Ritchie went crazy because that was the point. It was supposed to be like that, worn at the top. So that's why he doesn't play the guitar hardly at all anymore, because it's lost what it had in these performances. And a lot of people might think that it's got scallop frets, which is where the frets, and Yngwie Malmsteen is one of these players who has a guitar where the frets are shaped in a U shape, effectively. So it means that you don't push the string down onto the fretboard. It's actually just hovering above that. So then you can change the pitch of the string by pushing down on the string because it's not making contact with the fretboard. But anyway, let's not get into that. But a lot of people will see Ritchie's guitar here thinking that it has got scallop frets on it, but it hasn't. He's actually worn these down with sandpaper or whatever he did to sand those down. So it must have taken him ages. But anyway, let's get into the guitar here. And I'm going to try and give you a little bit of a representation of the sound or the sounds that Ritchie's got going on here. Because to begin with, this should be relatively clean here. We've got this D minor, and as you can hear on the top, taking that F down to the E, giving it that sus2 sound, really nice, and it's really understated as well. So when we've got this little bit of picking, and we've got a little bit of the keys in the background there, but also when we then break off into a little bit of lead, and this is where we have that kind of vibe. So, I mean, what I was doing there, this is all about the natural minor scale, but also you want to hammer on and pull off where you wouldn't normally. So, this is the great thing about Ritchie, the way that he applies these, those little trills and hammer-ons and pull-offs that are going on. So, he's playing the same note twice. Instead of going, he goes and does an extra little hammer on and pull off with that little finger there. And it's one of those themes that just runs throughout his playing, and he just goes through. I really like the sound of the natural minor scale, and it's something that I like to use myself, and it's something that takes the classic pentatonic shape. If you're used to playing the minor pentatonic, it moves you away from that and just gives you that little bit of neoclassical edge, which is what Ritchie is all about with his playing. But once you've worked your way down, we're back. And again, it's really understated here. So it means that all of the lines that he's playing have got to be super clean and with great technique. And Ritchie certainly has that. So you might find as well that as we ascend the fretboard, sometimes he'll have a little move up. And also, if you're getting all the way into your minor pentatonic shape one, you're going to be on this 10th fret, and you still want to apply that natural minor scale. And if you're playing in modes, if that's what you're into, this is the Aeolian mode, and having the... And you'll find all of those notes up there. And again, I'm in my minor pentatonic shape one here. And just a point about learning modes, learning scales, loads of people get confused, and I know because I teach guitar, about, you know, which mode do I use, which notes can I use, what should I be doing? And my, well, first of all, if you're trying to play lead guitar, I always started trying to play what I was thinking in my head, or the notes that I was singing in my head. So it means that whatever you're thinking of, if you can play it on the guitar, you don't need to know any scales or modes because you can just produce it, whatever you're thinking of. When you then start playing runs, then you might want to have a little bit of knowledge of that, but you can all just base it on top of the knowledge you've already got about minor pentatonic shape one and just place the other modes and scales within that. I'm just gonna get rid of the other part of the screen so you guys can see what's going on here. And when I was playing that D minor with that first finger coming on and off, you probably didn't see that, but you could hear it. And then when we jumped up, I'm now in that minor. It's going to be the natural minor scale, but don't worry too much about it, because what you can do is start to put modes and scales and just layer them on top of your minor pentatonic shape one, if that's what you want to do, or the extended shape if you're further down at the bottom of the guitar. So, for example, you'll know that as your extended pentatonic shape in the minor key. And just by placing down my first finger on the high E string and placing my first finger, more importantly, on the B string, that's where you can find a little bit of that natural minor scale. It's just the second finger on that high E string, but you want that first finger to be organized so that you've got one finger per fret. And that's why I mention it, because it means then you can start throwing lines together really quickly, because you don't have to move your hand. Your fingers are already where they need to be. So we've got that really tasteful playing going on. The other thing that you'll find, which I alluded to in the Deep Purple video, is the way that Ritchie just breaks up chords, or breaks up the notes from a chord, which is called arpeggiation, or playing an arpeggio. And what he does here, you might hear that kind of thing. So, I mean, all that happened there was that he played a D minor, but an octave higher, and just played those notes one at a time. And I did kind of fret that 12th fret of your D as well. If you want to go straight into it, it means that you've got those notes there. And you can do that little rundown if you want to. Again, another thing that Ritchie does. And doing that and just showing you what happened is that pick and the pick hammer-on pull-off. That, hopefully you can hear that. And then back into that D minor. So, I mean, there are so many little parts that you can look at with technique and things that Ritchie's doing. But once you start kind of getting into it and we start opening up dynamically, then we get more into this kind of heavier sound. And even at some point, we've got this. He's playing that open D string. And it's really starting to open up. This is the great thing about Richie when he's playing, is that he just lets everything go. And it doesn't really matter if he's hitting a wrong note here or there, because it's all part of the theatre and the drama and just going for it. And the best playing is always on the edge, that I said about Richie in that Deep Purple video that we did previously. So in terms of shapes and everything that's going on, I don't want to get too technical with it, but if you're taking this minor pentatonic shape one, I'd suggest that to begin with, when you're on the top, just to introduce one note per string, because that's all we're going to need for the natural minor scale or the Aeolian scale. And there's three strings of that, and all I'm doing is putting my second finger down, or I start on the high E string, because you place your third finger down, place that third finger down on the B string, place your second finger down, and take that first finger down one fret, and now you have that natural minor scale. And it's going to add so much to your playing because of all of that. You know, you can just play around with that particular shape, but those are the kind of notes that when you are playing, you'll naturally go to, or you'll sing those kind of lines, or at least I do, so that's why I use these notes quite a lot. But it just gives it a little bit more of a neoclassical edge to you're playing normally. And you'll find as well that there are no rules. You don't have to play within one particular mode or one scale. You can just find notes within your minor pentatonic shape that you like and then just keep going to them. And it might be the case that when you are playing, you might find that, oh, what happened there? You can find other notes that are actually from other modes, but you'll start to get the personality of those notes and how they feel, how they sound, and you won't have to learn the modes individually because you'll already be playing the modes within that one particular shape. So we've got lots of things going on here, and let me just mention about this delay we've got going on, because when Richie starts to kind of really open up dynamically, we've got all of this kind of, you know, and you might be able to hear that delay on there as well. It's a really wet sound, but wet sound means there's loads of effect on it, but it's such a great tone that he's got there. And it means that when we've got this, those kind of runs, you hear it repeated, and that's why it sounds so cool. And especially when you've got somebody like Richie, who, when he is playing, there's so much you can do in there with that natural minor scale, but with the distortion, with the delay as well, and if we're going, another thing that he does, which is exactly the same as what I demonstrated before in this D minor position, like that, and playing that same thing now in my pentatonic minor, my minor pentatonic shape one, it means that if I'm going, you can still access that little sweep, and I think he actually does that. That kind of thing, so you hear that little sweep before he comes in with the lead. So there's loads of technique in there, and it's great when you're listening to a great player, because also when he's starting this, he starts off the solo with a little run that my brain is trying to remember, but I think it was around this standard. He does his bend and then goes silent, and he has a little bit of a break, but then he comes in with that classic root note bend that he has, which is going up to his D, and obviously he then continues to just proceed to melt your face. And it's this kind of playing that does require a lot of technique because of the fact that he's going from clean tones to dirty tones, and he's got some great dirty tones going on here with the delay added as well. But it's very much just a delay added to this sound that he has that's a little bit more distorted. Kind of like that. And there's another part where we, you know, this video could go on for years, but there's another little bit where he's got this. He's kind of doing this double time strumming with that right hand. He actually goes. And then lets it run down again. So we've got so much going on here that is keeping your attention, because not only because of the choice of notes that he's choosing, but because of the technique involved and the showmanship, is everything rolled into one, so that all of the playing, you can sit down, try and work it out, and you can just have massive respect for the amount of technique on show. But the notes that he's choosing as well is going to make it interesting to listen to musically, because it's just pushing it on in that classical direction. I say neoclassical, but is something that Ritchie was one of those players that really brought that to the fore. So saying that he sounded neoclassical, he was one of those guys that everyone started thinking, oh, what's he doing there? How's these notes working? How are they working? What's he choosing? And then working out these extra scales and extra notes. But it's the way that he puts it together with the showmanship, the technical ability, and just being the center of attention the whole time, just making interesting choices all the way up the fretboard and not staying in one particular section, just changing his lead playing dynamically. So there is a lot going on here. Like I said, it could go on for years just breaking this down, but in a nutshell, here we've just got great playing on clean tones, on a dirty tone as well, with the delay, keeping your attention, pushing things to the edge, and not worrying if it doesn't sound super clean, because that's the whole point. And once we put all of those things together with just the drama of Ritchie Blackmore playing lead guitar, it's something that you can't take your eyes off. And another thing that's really to take away from it are the trills, the hammer-ons and the pull-offs especially. I know that it will be a case that when Ritchie's playing, he'll go into it, which he did in that Deep Purple video that we did previously, but that just trilling on different strings like that. But it's these little, the little hammer-ons and pull-offs that sound really cool and just give it an extra dimension. So that's something that you can start to throw in there. So I am going to be calling it a day. Just, I know we've gone over the half an hour limit that I usually try and set on these, but it's one of those things. There's so much technique here on show. Also, just before we finish, let me mention Ken. Thank you for that donation of $5. And also Paul for the $5 donation as well, and for the kind words. And Michael, who has donated $10 as well. So thank you for that, Michael. And oh, Michael says he wishes his guitar wasn't in the shop. So I hope you do get that back soon. But the great thing about these videos, you can just rewind them, watch them again. These are the live versions of the analysis videos, which happen on a Wednesday night, and that's at 12 midnight Greenwich Mean Time, the same time as the streams on a Tuesday and a Saturday. So if you want to tune in for a live one, Wednesday is the day in order to catch them. But thank you guys for tuning in tonight, and thank you Marilyn for that donation right at the end there of $5. And thank you everyone for joining me. I will catch you guys at the next one. Again, next Wednesday is when the next live analysis is happening, but I'll probably see you at the next analysis video or the next live stream. So thank you for joining me, and I'll see you guys then. Rock! And it looks like and and I'm just going to do another sign off because, I mean, some people would have probably stopped watching there, but this is a little bonus like you get at the cinema when you're watching the credits and then they come on screen again. So I think there was maybe a problem with the end of the live stream there. We did have this on a live stream last week, was it? But hopefully it's going to keep going. And it's going to end rather than going on endlessly like it did that last time. But hopefully this will work and I'll catch you guys at the next one. Just stay safe and have a great week and I'll see you then. Rock!